sometimes with morals to match.
The affairs that went on were just legendary. It adds a little bit of things going on at the table, glances across the candlelight. So lots and lots and lots of flirtations, lots of affairs. And as long as it's discreet, it's perfectly okay. I always think about these beautiful, beautiful houses where the parties are just spectacular. There is an element of these frissons underneath.
For the privileged few, it seemed that such extravagance need never end. No reason to believe the source of their wealth would ever change. For 1,000 years, the power base of British aristocrats had been rooted in their land. By the Edwardian era, they owned more than half the land in the country.
From the very beginning, land was power. The more land you had, the more power you had, the richer you were.
Dunham Massey, in the north of England, has been preserved as a classic Edwardian manor house.
Dunham Massey was the home of the Earls of Stamford. This family have always been influential. They've always entertained politicians and they were kinsmen to the kings and queens, so they had huge amounts of power. They maintained their power through holding a lot of land, because land was everything. The people who lived on your land paid you rent, and that's how you made money. You basically owned the land that they were living on.
Given this dependence on land, it was vital for the British aristocracy to keep their great country estates untouched and intact. So a tradition developed of handing the entire estate to the firstborn son, the heir. This practice, known as primogeniture, protected the integrity of the estate.
People who are in power like to perpetuate power. They like to hand it on to the next generation. That's how it works.
Nothing was to be whittled away or passed in other areas of the family. It went from eldest son to eldest son. So you had an accumulation of land. Land equals wealth. Wealth equals power. That was the equation.
One of the things that's really important to understand about primogeniture is the pride that accompanies it. The goal of each duke or of each peer or of each person who owns a large country estate is to hand it intact to his son. It is seen to be a real failure to not hand over the estate.
And not content with just all the land and all the money, the fortunate firstborn son inherited the title as well. Each became an earl, a marquis, or a duke the moment his father died. And with the title came political power. No need to stand for bothersome election. Aristocrats were entitled to sit in the House of Lords, Britain's upper house of government. There, they could veto any legislation. Not that elections were free and fair anyway. Only those with land had the vote. Powerful families ran the country from behind closed doors, drawing the power brokers of Britain into their dining room.
If you wanted to put a political idea across, you'd invite someone to dinner to stay with you for a weekend. Then you have them as a captive audience. You can spend time, you can virtually lobby them across the dinner table. Your guest of honour would have been seated in the centre of the table. So in one of these two chairs, your guest of honour. So that would be the person who you'd invited as the centre for your dinner party.
For centuries, the Earls of Stamford rubbed shoulders with the great and the good of the nation.
So here, at this dinner party, the guest of honour is the Lord Mayor of London, and seated right next to him is the Countess of Stamford. So very high up in terms of guest of honour. And we've also got the Governor of the Bank of England, so there's a lot of power around this table.
Land had underpinned all power in Britain for 1,000 years. But by Edwardian times, things were beginning to change. The agricultural revenues of the great country estates were declining.
The aristocracy had not invested well in their own agriculture. A lot of them were on hard times, although what the aristocrats call hard times would not have been recognised as hard times by anyone else.
What's happening from the 1870s onwards is that you are getting better transportation from Australia and from America, you're getting better refrigeration, so you're able to transport these grains and you're able to transport meat, and it's much cheaper.
The Industrial Revolution balanced the falling income from agriculture for a while. Industrialists paid top dollar to use the aristocrats' land. But as land became less important, power shifted away from those whose fortunes were rooted in agricultural estates.
The decline of the aristocracy is coming partly because of the changing notions of wealth. So wealth is moving into bankers and financiers and away from land.
And what's more, they couldn't even sell the land. A 13th century legal device known as entailment forbade an heir from selling off any part of the estate. In changing times, these vast estates, their grand houses and their retinues of servants, were becoming ruinously expensive to run. But the upper classes could draw on one further source of wealth: the riches of the far-flung British Empire. Britain's aristocracy ruled the colonies in much the same way as they did at home, making money from land and agriculture.
The great stately homes of Britain rested upon investment in imperial power. That's how they could pay all their servants. There is no upstairs, downstairs without the British Empire.
The British Empire was the largest empire the world has ever seen, and the famous phrase is the sun never set on the British Empire, because at some stage the sun was always shining on British territory. And I think at one stage the British Empire was about 25%, roughly a quarter of the territory of the globe. This was a period of imperial certainty. It looked as though the empire would last forever, rather like the American Empire today.
But in the early years of the 20th century, the supremacy of the British Empire was under threat.
There's also the period of the rise of nationalism. People wanted their own nation state. And this caused a crisis because it's the period of the rise of empire, but you also see within it the birth of movements such as nationalism that will destroy empire.
The seemingly inevitable decline of the empire was beginning to threaten the bankroll of Britain's ruling classes. Meanwhile, a new threat was looming, much closer to home. At the heart of the manor house, the division between upstairs and downstairs was creating an undercurrent of friction as the century drew on. The glittering social whirl upstairs contrasted ever more sharply with the endless drudgery of life below stairs.
In the early years of the 20th century, there would have been at least 100 meals prepared in this room every day. At this top end of the table, with his back to the window, there would have been the chef. He was usually French because French chefs were held in very high esteem and it was a sign of great prestige to have a French chef. Opposite him would be the kitchen maid, the head kitchen maid, and then down at the other end of the table would be the two junior kitchen maids, and they would do the basic preparation, chopping vegetables, all the simple jobs. Basically, it was non-stop, really, because there would be meals being served morning, noon and evening, and if there were any special events or special dinners, they may have to stay up, you know, till the last guest had gone to bed. So, yes, they were literally on the go almost all day long.
A kitchen maid earned $28 a year. An earl would easily spend many times that sum on the monthly bill for his food. These maids rarely strayed outside the kitchen. But the housemaids had to work all over the building. A housemaid's day started well before dawn. 17 hours of scrubbing floors, emptying grates, carrying coal, and tending the house.
The housemaids would spend all their time in the house, cleaning bedrooms, cleaning living rooms. They spent their days constantly running through tunnels, carrying heavy buckets and cans.
It was work most of the time, and the work was just the same thing every day. The stairs, the rooms, polishing, dusting. Everybody had their own jobs.
Bath time truly tested a housemaid's stamina, hauling 45 gallons of water for just one bath. And there were dozens of baths each evening. Even worse, they had to stay out of sight.
The housemaid's role was to be invisible. So if they were in the house, they had their own separate staircases, they had their own corridors. They were, in theory, supposed to stand still and leave the room if the Lord entered the room while they were there. They were not supposed to be there, basically, in the presence of the Lord and Lady of the house.
The house is divided. The servants lived, if you like, in their own quarters, which were, to an extent, cut off. Of course, they had to move in the rest of the house. They had to do so discreetly, quietly, not to speak unless spoken to, and to give a deferential and humble manner.
Between here and the main house, there was a tunnel going underground, and that was so that staff couldn't be seen crossing the courtyard, so that any visitors or guests of the family wouldn't be troubled by seeing staff milling about the place.
All maids were controlled by one woman, the housekeeper.
The housekeeper was a very important person. She was the most important female member of staff. Discipline was very strict. Even in the servants' quarters where the bedrooms were, the male and female staff had to use separate staircases. And if you were caught on the wrong staircase, you could be instantly dismissed.
Above the maids, the footman would serve the Lord and his family, which meant wearing a lavish uniform. In Edwardian times, a footman's livery was a status symbol, sometimes costing more than his annual salary.
Certainly, footmen in their uniforms probably felt quite superior to some of the sort of housemaids and so on.
Apart from the footman, it was only the butler who navigated the boundaries that separated upstairs from downstairs. Specially made doors were installed to keep the aristocrats free from the noises and smells of the servants.
Well, this door is a green baize door, and this marks the end of the servants' quarters and the start of above stairs.
Above stairs, everything had to be perfect.
Well, in the early 1900s, this is how a dining table would have been set for any formal luncheon or dinner as well. The footman was responsible for setting the table, for laying it out in this style. The butler would have come round after the footman and measured using what we call a yardstick, which is an old English measurement.